Can you imagine a situation where the court is deadlocked 4-4, which means the lower court opinions stand? And you could literally have a situation where the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals is saying Biden won the election. The Fifth, Eleventh Circuit are saying Trump won the election. Those cases come up to the Supreme Court. The court can't decide them, which means the lower court circuit opinions remain valid. Biden's president in the Ninth Circuit, Trump's president under the 11th and 5th Circuit. We're talking about a constitutional crisis. You throw in the actions of the left right now of rioting, burning things in the street, looting. This is dangerous. So we need this Ninth Justice to be confirmed as soon as possible, if for nothing else to prevent what the left seems to be gaming for, which is a civil war.
Joyful, joyful Lord, be adored.
This is the Dr. J Show, and as you've probably noticed, I'm not Jennifer Roback Morris. In fact, I'm Don Fetter. I'm the Communications Director and Coalition Coordinator of the Ruth Institute. Dr. Morris lives in Lake Charles, Louisiana, which got hit pretty hard with Hurricane Laura. So while she and her family are recovering, I'm filling in for her. And hopefully I'll do an adequate job. My guest, our guest, I should say, today is Phillip Chiragi. Phillip is a graduate of Stanford University, Cumberland School of Law. He's admitted to the practice of law before the United States Supreme Court, the United States Court of Appeals for the 11th Circuit, and all of Alabama's state and local courts. He was a law clerk to Chief Justice Perry O. Hooper of the Alabama Supreme Court, and he also served as an assistant legal advisor to Alabama Governor Fob James. Phillip, welcome to the show.
Thank you, Don. I'm glad to be here, and I may have to clarify one item on my resume.
Please.
There. Yes, I didn't attend Stanford Law School, but one slightly less prestigious Samford University Law School or Cumberland School of Law. So it's actually better than Stanford, but maybe a little less well known.
I'm sure it is. I worked for a congressional candidate in Massachusetts years ago. We used to refer to him as the doctor from Harvard. In fact, he was a dentist and he was from Harvard, Mass. But calling him the doctor from Harvard, I don't know, it just had a certain aura to it.
No kidding.
So this is an exciting time for someone like you, Phillip, who works on judicial nominations. We have, well, what's going to be an historic nomination.
It is.
The United States Supreme Court, Justice Amy Coney Barrett. Justice Barrett has been described as an originalist and a contextualist. What do those terms mean?
So to look at originalist and textualist, you would want to go back to Article 3 of the Constitution, which creates the judicial branch of government. And it says that the role of the judiciary is to, quote, decide cases and controversies. And so what that means is if two people in our society have a disagreement and they talk about it and they can't resolve it and they get lawyers and still can't resolve it, then they go to what's called court. That's what Article 3 is there for, to resolve disputes. And in resolving disputes, the court never sits like a King Solomon and just hears everything and decides what it thinks is right. The job of courts under our Constitution is to look to the law, which has already been written by the legislative branch. And interestingly, Article 1 of our Constitution, which describes the legislative branch and creates it, says all legislative power herein granted shall be vested in Congress, which means all power to make rules and laws lies in Congress. None lies with the court. So an originalist is one who doesn't try to write law or remake law, but who looks at the original public meaning of the law, which could be a constitutional provision or a statute, and applies that to the facts of the case and yields a result, a winner or loser in a lawsuit. Textualist means the same thing. It's looking at the text of a law to determine What does that text mean? Originalism is talking more about the original public meaning of something. In other words, what did that text mean, not just to the authors of the legislation, but what did that text mean to the people who were hearing it in those days, the original public meaning? So these are key concepts. They're very important. They're really not, and they shouldn't be conservative concepts. These are really just honest concepts. In other words, the job of a judge is not to remake the law conservative or liberal. It's just rule according to the law that's already been written.
So the First Amendment, for instance, you would look at the debate that went on in Congress when the amendment was adopted, and in the states for that matter, and the intent of Mr. Madison and the other authors of the First Amendment, the Bill of Rights, rather than saying, well, you know, I think the First Amendment should mean this. The idea of a living constitution, which I'm sure you're familiar with. So it's you're looking at the intent of the framers, if you will, the intent of the Congress that enacted the statute, the law, if it's a law, or the intent of the Congress that adopted the amendment.
Yes, and it's even a little more specific than that, because what we're talking about is the original public meaning, not necessarily the original intent of one of the authors of the legislation, which is relevant, but the original public meaning. And the reason that can be important is nowadays, some mischief can take place with talking about legislative intent, because you may have one legislator who sponsors a bill. The bill says one thing, it has a public meaning, but then the author comes back later and says, well, let me tell you what I intended, okay? That can be a dangerous thing and can end up allowing one sponsor, co-sponsor, person that voted for the bill to try to change the meaning of it by restating an intent. So the real question is, yes, intent's relevant, and what the authors of the First Amendment, the Constitution, wrote and thought it meant is very important. But even the bigger picture is, what was the original public meaning, if that makes sense? It's a
it makes perfect sense.
Yeah.
So, another example from the Bill of Rights. What did the right to keep and bear arms mean to the public in the late 18th century at the time the amendment was adopted?
Well, it's interesting because they didn't use the term gun. You know, they used the term arms. And when you talk about there being a call to arms, I don't really want to get into that because that could be a very controversial subject at the moment. But they were talking about the need for the people to be able to organize as a militia to defend themselves against an oppressive government. I mean, we just went through a revolution. Right. So it was very important to them that the people have the ability to defend themselves in war against an oppressive government, which, of course, included the personal right to own arms, which is exactly what the court came back and recognized in the Heller case at the Supreme Court. And that's talking about the Second Amendment. That's the real core of what they were looking to protect and why.
Certainly. Is it unusual, Phillip, for a president to fill a vacancy on the Supreme Court this close to an election?
What would be absolutely 100% unprecedented would be for the president to not make a nomination when there's a vacancy. As a matter of fact, the Constitution calls for him to do that, to nominate with the advice and consent of the Senate to make a nomination. And that's exactly what the president's done. So I would say it's not unusual for the president to make a nomination. What is unusual is the circumstances that we found ourselves in with the passing of Justice Ginsburg.
Okay. What will Judge Barrett's opponents do? What will the Democratic Party do to stall a vote, to try to delay it?
Yes, I think we can look back at what they've done in prior hearings. And even with Judge Kavanaugh, they tried to call for additional documents or say, we need to ask additional questions or we need an FBI investigation. And this is all going to take, of course, a lot more time, right? And so here you can only imagine, I mean, the election is coming up on November 3rd. The confirmation vote would probably take place the week before that. So what I expect Democrats to do is between now and the committee hearing to be making claims and calls for additional documents, or they need something that they don't have, or there's something that they think needs to occur that's outside of the normal schedule. Or like they did with Judge Kavanaugh, at the very end of his hearings, everything was kind of cruising along, and you know, the Democrats were acting up from time to time, and the Republicans were doing their thing, and we got to the end of it, and then all of a sudden, there's this issue that has to be looked into, and we need more time, and why would you rush this through, and et cetera, et cetera. So I think we can anticipate the same type thing here. In the middle of the hearing, toward the end of the hearing, the second the hearing closes, Democrat senators will stand up and demand that something has to happen, or we need to look into the adoption records of her children that they adopted from Haiti, or something about something. And they'll say it requires more time, and because that's their goal. If they can drag it out, of course, they get to November 3rd, and now we're in a whole new era.
You know, you mentioned the adoptions, and I find this interesting. There are people on the left who are saying there's something suspect about a white couple adopting black children. I think, what is the expression that they've used? Colonialists?
Yeah.
White, because they're Americans and they want to give a home to people, children, in a country that's sunk in poverty and has been such for most of its history, you know, this is suspect. Somehow this is oppressive. But at the same time, the other side thinks it's wonderful when a gay couple adopts a child. That's fine. You know, it's fine for two men or two women to adopt a child because, you know, you don't need a male and a female role model, mother and father. That's all passe. But for a white couple to take a child in Haiti and give that child a home in the United States where they have a chance of a decent life, that's suspect.
Yes, and you know, you can only imagine. I jokingly said, Don, I jokingly said, you know, they'll claim that Judge Barrett, who's a woman, is not even a woman. They'll claim that because she's adopted two African-American children, that she's a racist somehow. Well, I said that jokingly, and now all of a sudden, that's what they're saying. Somehow she's a racist because she has two adopted children.
It's unbelievable.
You can't win with these people, you know. It's yep. But the good news is they are so desperate that that's the kind of stupid stuff they're saying. And so it's why I think even Dick Durbin, Senator Dick Durbin, no genius, but Dick Durbin said, well, we don't think we can stop this nomination. And I pray he's right, but they will not be able to stop it, even with all these silly antics they're engaging in.
Well, you're right. This truly is grasping at straws.
Yeah.
But then, you know, they've already brought up her religion. Not Catholicism per se. It's all right to be a Catholic if you're a Catholic like Joe Biden, or you know, a Catholic like
Pelosi,
Nancy
right.
Pelosi.
Sure.
If you know, if you say you're a Catholic because you come from a Catholic family, but it means nothing to you, that's okay.
That's right.
But if you're a Catholic who actually believes in Catholicism, you know, that's. Again, I hope I'm not overusing the word. It's suspect, which of course, the First Amendment doesn't say. The First Amendment says no religious test for public office. Period.
What this reminds me of, Don, as you're saying this, is you'll remember the hearings for Justice Clarence Thomas. He made the point, Justice Thomas's own words. He said, "I was the wrong black guy." In other words, he was black and the Democrat Party says that they like black people, but not this black guy. He was the wrong black guy is what Justice Thomas said. And I would say, you think of, you know, the term rhino, Republican in name only. Well, we could invent a new term, Chino, a Christian in name only. And, you know, they don't mind. Matter of fact, not only do they not mind Biden being a Catholic, they brag on it all the time, reminding everyone, oh, he's a man of faith. He's Catholic. But apparently, Amy Coney Barrett is the wrong kind of Catholic. Just like with Justice Clarence Thomas, when he went through his hearings, Justice Thomas made the statement, this isn't my statement, Justice Thomas made the statement that he was the wrong black man. They wanted someone perhaps African-American, but not someone who thought like Justice Clarence Thomas thought. He was the wrong black guy is what Justice Clarence Thomas said. And the same could be said here with Judge Amy Coney Barrett. She's the wrong Catholic. She's the wrong woman. They'd like a woman to be on the court, but not that kind of woman. Not one who thinks like Judge Amy Coney Barrett thinks. Not one who thinks like so many tens of millions of suburban moms all across this country. You know, it's so hypocritical that some claim to stand for women, but they really don't. They stand for a certain small slice of type of women, but not all women, certainly not the type who thinks like Amy Coney Barrett thinks. By the way, when she thinks, she's brilliant. She can defend herself better than anybody. And because of that too, I really do look forward to this hearing and seeing how she performs.
One of the things I find interesting is that even the people at Notre Dame Law School, her colleagues, who disagree with her violently on interpretations of the Constitution, nevertheless say she's a brilliant scholar, she's objective, she's fair-minded, and these accolades are coming from people who disagree with her on constitutional questions.
Exactly, and on that point, Noah Feldman, a law professor who clerked with her at the time at the Supreme Court, she clerked for Justice Antonin Scalia, a famous constitutionalist, and Feldman didn't clerk for Scalia. He clerked for one of the other justices on the court at that time. But Noah Feldman, even within the last, I think, 2 or 3 days, wrote a glowing piece basically saying, yes, I disagree with Judge Amy Coney Barrett, and I would rather see someone on the court who thinks like I, Noah Feldman, think. He said, but you can't deny her brilliance, her ability, her background, her resume, her kindness even, the way she treats people. And he said, she's exactly what we need on the Supreme Court, even though he doesn't like her judicial philosophy, he recognizes it. And in honesty, everybody on the other side that's fair has said the same thing in the past. Every law clerk, Don, that clerked with her at the Supreme Court in her back when she clerked there, when she was nominated to the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, endorsed her. Now you're talking about law clerks, many of whom are on the absolute opposite spectrum in terms of their views and their judicial philosophy, but to a person, every one of them said, she's fantastic, and they endorsed her. Now, will they do that again? The stakes are higher for the U.S. Supreme Court than they were for the Seventh Circuit, but if they're consistent, intellectually consistent, they would endorse her again.
Well, I'm sure there'll be a lot of senators, Democratic senators, who voted for her, voted to confirm her to the Seventh Circuit Court of Appeals, who are going to change their minds now and decide that she's not qualified to serve on the Supreme Court. I was reading an article about Judge Barrett's nomination that said that if she's confirmed, this will be the first time since the New Deal era that you've had a solid conservative majority on the Supreme Court. Would you agree with that?
You know, I'd have to look more carefully. Most of my research, Don, has been since the 1960s. I don't have a ton of depth during the New Deal era. I've read what you just cited, and I don't have any reason to disagree with it. But I can certainly say in the last 50 years, the last 60 years, the last two generations, in my judgment, the court has never been conservative. Another way to say it is the court has never been constitutional. And there is a chance, I believe we've reached a tipping point and we are headed toward that. So it's a journey. We're not there yet, but we have definitely turned. It's like, I like to think of, and a lot of time, the way we've prayed for the Supreme Court, in the New Testament, Jesus told this parable, what's called a story or the parable of the prodigal son, who left his father's house, who left his heritage and went to a far country with money and spent it with wild living. But there came a point, it says, where he came to his senses and said, I will go back to my father's house. And if I were likening the Supreme Court to that parable, I would say we're right now at that moment where the prodigal son came to his senses and said, I will go back. So I really see the Supreme Court as coming back to its proper purpose, its noble role. It has a noble role. And for some reason, judges decided deciding cases and putting on a black robe is not good enough. We want to be politicians. But we have reached a point, I believe, where that's changing, and we're headed back to the point where judges put on that robe and they honestly and with integrity simply decide cases and don't insert themselves into the political life of the nation.
Well, that would be refreshing, to say the least. I mean, you know, so often, like you, Phillip, I graduated from law school. I graduated a few years before you did, actually a few decades before you did, if I'm not mistaken. But I've been looking at this battle now for, it seems at times, forever. And, you know, some of the contortions that liberal courts will go to make the Constitution fit their philosophy or their ideology are just amazing. Abortion, for instance. I mean, you have liberals like Alan Dershowitz who say, yes, I agree that women should have a right to abortion, but Roe v. Wade was still wrongly decided.
Exactly. And so that really just highlights the problem that everybody knows it's a joke. Everyone knows the emperor has no clothes, and yet we're all supposed to stand around and talk about how beautiful the emperor looks with these incredible clothes, but the emperor's naked. I mean, I know it, you know it, Alan Dershowitz knows it, pro-abortion Democrat, law professors, everybody knows it. And yet we have to act and play this charade about what a enshrined constitutional right abortion is. Well, it's not. It's not. And Democrats get so worried about that being reversed. Well, if they like abortion so much, why don't they try to implement it through the legislative process? The Constitution, actually, Article 5 provides a way to create abortion in the Constitution if they want it. It's called the amendment process.
Right.
But you can't do it with as few as five or six unelected lawyers in black robes in a meeting room at the Supreme Court. That's not amending the Constitution. That's usurpation. It's rebellious, and it's what the court has done. And is it any wonder that from 1973 until today, this issue has never been resolved? It's still being argued about. In this very hearing for this justice now, 47 years later, it'll continue to be the biggest topic. And the reason is because the left didn't go about this the right way. They went about it by usurping power and foisting abortion on all of the United States.
There are few issues that are more controversial, that are more hotly debated or contested than abortion in this country. Speaking, Philip, of Roe v. Wade, what does the expression stare decisis mean?
Well, it's a Latin phrase that means a thing decided. But precedent never has the power to change the law. The law is what's written by the legislative branch. Precedent never has the authority to change the law. And what's important is, and this is honestly, Don, what distinguishes Amy Coney Barrett from all the other judicial nominees I've researched, is precedent has weight. Stare decisis is a valid consideration, but it doesn't change the fact that when a judge or a justice takes their oath of office, they don't take their oath of office to stare decisis or precedent or to what other judges who've come before them have thought the law says or whether they've even usurped power. A judge takes their oath to the Constitution. And so Judge Barrett, and I'll actually read a quote, if I may,
please,
of what she said. She says, I tend to agree with those who say that a justice's duty is to the Constitution and that it is thus more legitimate for her to enforce her best understanding of the Constitution rather than a precedent she thinks clearly in conflict with it. In other words, the judge or justice takes their oath to the Constitution, and if they see that a precedent, decisions of other judges, conflicts with the Constitution, then they have a decision to make. Are they going to follow the Constitution, or are they going to follow other judges? And of course, the oath isn't to the other judges, it's to the Constitution. That's what Judge Barrett has said, and it's absolutely correct.
And you have instances of the same court coming out with decisions that are completely contradictory. I'm not sure if I have the dates right, but I believe in the 1980s, the Supreme Court said that state anti-sodomy laws were constitutional. And then, I think 20 years later, they said, no, they're not constitutional. They're a violation of, I forget what it was, equal protection, perhaps. And Judge Kennedy, no, I'm sorry, not Judge, was it Judge Kennedy? I believe it was Judge Kennedy, came down on the opposite side of those two decisions. First, he said anti-sodomy laws were constitutional, and then he said they weren't constitutional.
That's right. If liberals think that that's what the policy should be with regard to sodomy, what do? Well, go pass a law. I mean, that's what legislation is for. That's what this nation allows. But for a judge like Justice Kennedy, one day to make a proclamation about what the Constitution says, and then a decade or so goes by and he makes the exact opposite conclusion about what the Constitution says, guess what didn't change? The Constitution. Guess what did change? Culture, people's opinions. Justice Kennedy changed. So again, there's a way to go about this, and it's not by judges deciding what they would like the Constitution to say over time. You just read it and apply it. And if you want to be a politician, for crying out loud, take off your robe, go get a piece of paper, fill it out, run for office.
But hasn't the left always viewed the court as the ultimate check on the will of the people? It's something like the House of Lords used to be in Britain. You know, the House of Lords was the ultimate check on democracy or representative government. The House of Commons could do something, but if the House of Lords felt strongly that it was wrong, they could simply put a stop to it. I think that's what the left wants when it comes to the courts. They want their own House of Lords. They view the judiciary, the Supreme Court in particular, as the ultimate check on popular government. So they're saying to the American people, yes, you can do certain things, but you can't go too far.
That's right. And you could also liken it to a Politburo. You could liken it to a judicial oligarchy, which is probably about the best description you could have, because what we've had over the last 50 years is, it's kind of like this judicial oligarchy will let Congress, sort of play with their toys and do certain things. But if they try to make any law that the Supreme Court disagrees with, then the judicial oligarchy just steps in. And a great example would be the Child Online Protection Act, which was, again, 12, 13, 15 years ago. But Congress kept passing this law to protect children from online pornography, and the court would come in and strike it down and say that's unconstitutional. So Congress would come back and spend, who knows how much blood, sweat, and tears and millions of dollars with lobbyists amending the law, and they'd pass it. I mean, this is hard work, right? The Senate passes it. It goes to the president. We happen to have a president who will sign it. He signs it, and the Supreme Court comes back again and says, bam, unconstitutional. Well, never violated the Constitution. So it is a real problem that the court has been constantly basically running America. And until you deal with that institutional problem, in essence, it doesn't matter if you win some congressional races and take the House and the Senate and the White House. You can hold all three of them. But if you don't deal with the institutional problem of the court, you're going to win a victory and then lose it, which is, again, what's happened, which is why it's so important, the position we're in right now of taking the court over with hopefully constitutionalists who will not rule one way or the other on policy. They'll just let the political branch figure it out and then let them keep their victories.
The left has given the court so much power that, ultimately it's more important. The majority of the Supreme Court is more important than Congress, more important than the president. That's not what the Founding Fathers intended, but it's become this.
Exactly. And you hit the nail on the head, Don, because as the court has expanded its power, it's no longer an Article III legislative branch court. It's become a super legislature. It's become the most powerful body in our nation that makes policy. And because of that, is it any wonder that when these confirmations come up, they're taken like a presidential election, and in some ways even more important, because a president will serve for 4 to 8 years. But a justice, Amy Coney Barrett, for example, if Amy Coney Barrett is confirmed and lives to the age that Ruth Bader Ginsburg lives, she will serve for 40 years. That's 10 times as much as a presidential term, 40 years. And so, yes, the left takes it incredibly serious, because for them, this is how they've run the nation for the last 50, 60 years.
Let's say the confirmation process plays out until we're almost on top of the election, which may very well be the case, as you pointed out. How does this play out in the election?
Here's how the dynamic works, and it's why, number one, the seat needs to be filled now, because we don't need an eight-member court that could be deadlocked and then hearing election cases, which could create a true constitutional crisis unlike anything we've seen since the Civil War. That's not an exaggeration. We could talk about that more. But I think what's going to happen is the Senate will confirm Judge Barrett probably the week before, days before the election. And what will happen is Democrats will be mad, liberals will be mad, but they're mad anyway. They've been mad for months, and they'll continue to be mad through the election and after the election. You know, let them deal with it. We have the constitutional authority to do it. Don't wait. Don't listen to their whining. Don't listen to their rioting, their demonizing, frothing on the ground. Just ignore them and go about the business that the Constitution gives the president and the Senate the authority to do, which is confirm this nominee.
Well, I hope that Republicans keep reminding people of what happened in 2000. If you'd had a divided court then, we could still be recounting ballots in Florida.
No kidding. No kidding. And can you imagine a situation, Don, where after the election, and we already see the Democrats are literally talking about litigation already. They're prepping the American people for what the Democrats plan to do, which is create as much chaos as they can by this cheat by vote by mail situation, total chaos, then blame the chaos on Republicans, file lawsuits, and go running to the court to fix it. Now that when Barrett gets put on the court, it'll change that. But can you imagine a situation where the court is deadlocked 4-4, which means the lower court opinions stand? And you could literally have a situation where the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeals is saying Biden won the election. The Fifth, 11th Circuit are saying Trump won the election. Those cases come up to the Supreme Court. The court can't decide them, which means the lower court circuit opinions remain valid. Biden's president in the Ninth Circuit, Trump's president under the 11th and 5th Circuit. We're talking about a constitutional crisis. You throw in the actions of the left right now of rioting, burning things in the street, looting. This is dangerous. So we need this Ninth Justice to be confirmed as soon as possible, if for nothing else, to prevent what the left seems to be gaming for, which is a civil war.
No, it's interesting. The left has been telling us for years that you can't have statues of Confederate generals because this honors the South. This honors the secessionist cause. And yet today they're the secessionists. Go back to sanctuary cities.
Sure.
Yeah. What are sanctuary cities except lesser jurisdictions that are saying to the United States government, your laws don't run here. We're going to decide what to do with illegal immigrants, not you, which is basically what the South said prior to the Civil War.
That's right.
You know, they said, we don't care what you decide about slavery. We're going to decide what to do ourselves.
Yep. And the South, they were rightly called rebels for what they were doing. But the same term applies to what we're seeing now in sanctuary cities and in other states where they're being rebels. And so, it's a serious situation, and it's the reason we have three branches of government. It's the reason we have an independent judiciary, and having a Ninth Justice on the court is absolutely essential so that we can resolve these cases.
Can you think of any scenario in which the election would be thrown into the House of Representatives, which is what happened in 1800.
Yes, under the scenario that I described.
But the court is divided.
Sure, the court is divided, or for some reason appeals are coming up through the system, and the court's not able to decide this election, then yes, we could end up in that situation where the House of Representatives under the Constitution is having to address it.
We could have ended up with Aaron Burr as the third president of the United States. Wow. Scary thought. Yep. No, it's ironic. Hillary Clinton, who dreamed the 2016 campaign, kept accusing Donald Trump of refusing to accept the results of an election if it didn't turn out the way he wanted it to. And now she's telling Biden, don't concede. It doesn't matter what the vote count is, don't concede.
Right. And again, it shows you what their strategy is, that what they're trying to do is have so many ballots thrown all over the place, vote by mail. They're going to claim we have more votes coming in. Well, you know what they're going to do is sit back on election night and say, oh, so-and-so for the Senate is behind by 12,000 votes. You know, get us the votes. We have 7 days now because of this cheat by vote by mail. And all of a sudden, lo and behold, Susie pulls up and in her trunk are four boxes with 13,000 votes for fill in the blank Democrat. And I'm not kidding about this. I'm not just trying to be funny. This is literally what we're facing. Cheating, stealing of elections. And so it needs to be dealt with. I know that Attorney General Barr is doing his best in looking into this and has teams of people. The difficulty is that this isn't going on in just one state. It's going on throughout the country, different precincts within the states. And so it's a real problem. I'm thankful the president has talked about it and continues to talk about it. I'm also thankful that fraud is being uncovered daily of what's happening out there, including, of course, you saw the story, I'm sure, where military votes from overseas were literally thrown into a ditch.
Yeah.
Not count. How'd that happen? I mean, seriously, you know?
So it must have been sunspots. Maybe global warming had something to do with it. Yeah. You know, I thought that vote by mail, which, as you know, is quite different than absentee ballots. I thought vote by mail was bad, but vote harvesting?
Yes.
Can you explain what that is?
It's where teams of people or people will go out and collect ballots supposedly of people who are voting and bring those ballots in groups of 10, 20, 1,000, 2,000, 10,000, and they'll just bring these ballots in. No security measures.
And that's legal in some areas.
Yes, and it's scary. I mean, absentee voting is totally different. For us, for example, in our state, when we vote absentee, you have to go in with identification to prove you are who you say you are. They look at your name, make sure you're a registered voter in that county. They give you a ballot. You sit before them and fill out a notary. I mean, a notary. Witnesses, they look at your ballot, they seal it. Think of all the protective measures that are there to ensure that the person voting is voting and that they're only voting once. And then you compare that to supposedly vote by mail, where thousands of ballots go out to people who haven't asked for them, many of whom don't even live in the state anymore. I have friends in my state who used to live in other states that are doing vote by mail that have gotten ballots at their home in another state. They're not even qualified legally to vote in that state, and yet they're getting ballots. This is scary. Of course, you also talk about if people can counterfeit money, do you think they could counterfeit a ballot? Mm. Of course they can. So why wouldn't somebody who wants to win the election in, say, China, print up 10, 20, 100,000 ballots for a certain jurisdiction, fill them out. You don't have to put a name down. You don't have to prove who voted. Give them to a ballot harvester and then just let them sit around on election night and say, how many votes do we need? Right? I mean, this could totally happen. And I think it's exactly what the left would do to win this election. You see how desperate they are. They would certainly do that, I believe.
And they are desperate. There's so much riding in this election. Probably as much. I can't think of an election other than, well, perhaps 1860, where you've had as much riding on the outcome as you do this election.
I agree. I mean, it's a, you know, it's that tried expression. Well, this is the most important election in our lifetimes. And, you know, maybe all those statements were true, but it certainly is true now. And even more than that, like what you said, Don, I think this is at least in the top two most important presidential elections in the history of our nation. We need to fight really hard to make sure we have a Supreme Court that's fully empowered with 9 justices so that we don't end up with a dangerous situation with a deadlocked Supreme Court and these Democrat mobs in the street doing what they're doing.
You said it very well. All right, Phillip, one final question, if I may. What justices, you know, Ruth Bader Ginsburg died, of course, just a few weeks ago. What other justices may retire in the next year or in the next few years?
I think I know the next oldest justice is Justice Stephen Breyer. He's 80. He may be 81 now, but 80. I'm not trying to call for him to retire, but certainly when you look at age, he's one that you would look to as someone who might retire. You know, other people have talked about Justice Clarence Thomas, who's only, I think, 71 years old.
Really?
Yes.
He's only 71.
He may be 72. I think he's 71.
Maybe he's 71. A young whippersnapper.
He's a whippersnapper, exactly. And he's really come into his own recently. He's always been an amazing justice, but really, I think, has gone to a new level of his influence. And I think the younger justices on the right, the constitutionalists, really need Clarence Thomas to be there. He has just, in my opinion, a real lion's voice in terms of how he speaks, the power, the authority that he speaks with. And I don't want to see him leave. I'd love to see him serve for another 10, 15 or more years. Justice Alito just turned 70. I think he was a bit frustrated with some of the actions of this last court. There was some chatter about him perhaps.
You could tell that from some of his opinions.
Yeah. And so thankfully he did not retire, and he's a great justice as well. I'd put him right next to Clarence Thomas. I hope that Justice Alito will stay on the court for a long time, because again, you try to replace somebody, there's no guarantee you're going to get somebody as great and solid as Samuel Alito. So we'll see. And then you never know, you know, maybe Sotomayor might decide it's time to go. Maybe Elena Kagan wants to go back to academia. So I would encourage them that this would be a nice time for them to retire, Sotomayor and Kagan, and, you know, find another job, make a little more money. We'll get somebody else to take a shot.
Interestingly, Phillip, there are liberals who are blaming Ruth Bader Ginsburg for all of this. They're saying, why didn't you retire when Obama was president? She had cancer at the time. She's been in ill health for years and years. And they're saying, you know, why did you take a chance?
And, you know, some of them are the same people who have treated her as a hero. And it just goes to show that they really didn't so much like Ruth. What they liked was the power and what they could get from her. I think in some ways, Amy Coney Barrett is a fitting successor. She's nowhere near Ruth Bader Ginsburg on her political positions and her judicial philosophy. But Amy Coney Barrett is a true pioneer. And I think she'll take, just as Justice Ginsburg had views on feminism, Amy Coney Barrett does too. But it's a different type. It's a different view of what womanhood is and what a mother is. Justice Ginsburg was a mother as well. I don't mean to imply that. But Amy Coney Barrett will be a different type pioneer, but nonetheless a great pioneer for women who love her and admire her.
I think that's a good place to end. Phillip Jauregui, Judicial Action Group, who's going to be in the thick of this battle, I'm sure, to fill the vacancy on the Supreme Court. Thank you for taking the time to be with us today.
It's an honor, Don, and I love hanging out with you. I appreciate you giving me the opportunity.
Well, same here.
You've been listening to the Dr. J Show, a production of the Ruth Institute. The Ruth Institute equips Christians to defend the family and build a civilization of love. Check out our website at ruthinstitute.org for helpful resources and support. join us on Facebook. Our podcasts can also be found online at ruthinstitute.org. I'm Father Mark Hodges. Thank you for watching.